to dwell in unity. It says the anointing that flowed down even over the beard of Aaron. And it looks like summer's over, and it looks like we're heading into our fall time. And how many of you ready for the 90 and 107 degree weather to be over with? Yes. Amen. Now you can complain about the 20 and the minus 10 degree weather. Amen. No. Well, the good thing is you can go in the air conditioning in the summer and you can turn on the heat in the winter. Someone want to tell me how that works? And just stay in the house, right? That'll get it done. Praise. You know, I used to lay carpet, and my favorite thing to do was see the guys who were out there, and they were working on the construction, and they'd be around a barrel with the scrap wood like this. My favorite thing to do was go to the window with a cup of coffee and go, needless to say, they just sort of look over once and just pretend like they didn't see. You know, just sort of stand in the window, short sleeve shirt. Funny how that works. We were ornery. Still are. But I want you to know that this has got to be the orneriest church I've ever been in. Pastor, let us throw pie at you. Worst part is you got a pastor that went, okay, why not? I'm still, my eyes are swollen and I'm trying to get the rest of the whipped cream out of there, but it was wonderful. My wife's going to come. She has something to say, and then I'm going to have Amanda come. Praise God. We didn't get the class for the missionary. Oh, that's right. The missionary needs, yeah, let's do that. Go get one.
Well, praise the Lord. For some of you who are involved in our church, we had a carnival yesterday, and it was awesome. We had so many kids that came, and I don't even know how many people came. Probably 100 plus, you know, people came and brought kids, and we just had such an awesome time, and we just appreciate all the volunteers, all the hard work, all the planning.
A lot of work.
I can't say thank you enough to everybody who was involved, but God just smiled upon us and blessed us yesterday, and we're just so excited that he's going to give us fruit from that, because we had a lot of people we talked to and in our community invited them to church, and some said they would come, and some are going to bring their kids to our Awanas program starting up here in a couple weeks, pretty soon. And so anyhow, thank you so much. I just appreciate all of you. God bless you.
Amen. She said we can't appreciate you enough, but there is one thing I can do. I watched yesterday as some were here for 12 hours, maybe even more, and some. One man came up to me a day and said, I didn't even want to get up this morning. Well, I'm going to give all of you a break. Hello, we're going to dismiss service for tonight. And I know that those who come on the evening service are the ones who are usually working out there or working in one capacity or the other. And the interesting thing about all of that is when you have that many people with a mind to work, they build the church. Because the church is you. Say, I am the church.
I am the church.
What? What'd you say?
I am the church.
That's right. We are God's people. Some are a little more excited than others, but Can't do anything about that, but say praise God for what he's doing. All you ladies that were in here working and the chili coney dog I had last night. Oh, yeah, yeah. Lots of ketchup and mustard on that thing. Well, ketchup, I can't remember. I passed out. You know, I had a rough job. I had to do the blowing of the rocks, and then that was enough to get dust in your eyes. I took the whipped cream. I can see I got whipped cream facial. So smooth. Are they costly? Well, they were costly for others. I got it free. And some threw it so hard, even my nostrils got a free massage there. It was so fun. It really was. I'd do it again for the sake of the gospel anytime. Brother Dave. It's just not the same. You know, how many can think it'd be the same if I had goggles on? It's just not the same, you know? I guess, you know, it's the torture I take upon myself, you know, but all things for the glory of God, right? Amen. Sister Amanda, would you come? Because she has something she wants to share with us. We're glad you're home. Even smaller.
Maybe even shorter.
Yeah. So proud. Or you can hold it.
No, this works. Thank you.
Okay.
So I'm going to have a few pictures behind me, but I'm going to show a picture video at the end, which will have more, but I just picked a few to kind of show as I talk. But first, I just want to thank all of you for being a part of this and for sending me, supporting me in my time in Moldova and praying for me and what God was doing there. So God is doing amazing things there as well. And I'm just thankful to be a part of that and to be invited to be a part of what God is doing. So this is a map of Moldova. It's kind of blurry, but it's sandwiched in between Romania and Ukraine. No. And I had a chance. I was there all of July, so I had an opportunity to join two different outreach teams. And the first 2 weeks, we went to the northern western side of Moldova into two villages there. And we got to partner with the local Baptist church and a local Pentecostal church in these areas. And we did children's programs, kind of like the carnival yesterday. It was very similar to that. And we would do that every morning and also do puppet shows and Bible stories and verses with the kids. And then in the afternoons, the church would connect us with families to go visit. And they would welcome us right into their homes. And we would just spend time with them and listen to their stories and then share our testimonies and how Jesus has changed our lives. And we would do youth nights as well with the kids.
Wow.
So it was pretty packed, packed month. Every day was pretty busy, but God renewed our strength every day. So you can go to the next slide. So this is a picture of an Orthodox church, and below it are pictures of icons. So in Moldova, the big religion there is Eastern Orthodox, and they do say Jesus, they do say God, but you could see that it's really turned into worship of saints, worshiping icons. And so the people there have really traded truth for a lie. And they're believing these things, and they're believing that God is a distant God, and that they really feel that God is angry with them because they're in these situations. They think God doesn't love them. And so when we got to share, they've never heard a God like this. They've never heard that Jesus wants to be close and have a relationship with them and that he loves them dearly. So we got to share that message of hope with the people there. Because a lot of them feel hopeless. They feel lonely. They feel depressed because it's a very impoverished country. And so we just got to come with joy and share what we know Jesus can do for people. So you can go to the next one. So the picture up top of this gentleman up there, we went there and he had no family left in the country. All his children had to leave to find work. And so he was just crying because he just felt forgotten. And he also believed these kind of same things, that God was angry with him. And so we got to pray with him. And he was very thankful just for our prayers and for the love that we had to share. And then below, this lady there in the middle, she had never had a Bible before in her life. And we had Bibles in Romanian, and she wanted one. And so we gave her one to be able to grow in her faith and be able to read it for herself. And then over here with this little boy, this little boy, when I first saw him, never smiled. And he, you could tell, was very, very heartbroken, very sad. His older sister would take care of him a lot, who's only 9 years old herself. And as we continued to just play with him, and he'd come every day to the children's program, he began to smile, and he began to open up and hug us and want to be around us. And we ended up getting to visit his family. And this family is probably one of the poorest in the community. Both parents, mainly the dad, were alcoholics. They had no jobs and went towards these other things because they felt hopeless. So these children suffered because of it. But God's faithful, and this little boy by the end smiling and jumping around and rejoicing with us. So that was a blessing. So you can go to the next one. So then in that second village we went to, we visited this lady up top. She had another similar story of her family leaving. So she's taking care of her daughter's 10-year-old son. And so she felt that she wasn't able to really provide for this child like she would hope she could. And so it's just kind of time after time you hear these stories of elderly taking care of the grandchildren and parents leaving. And then they're feeling forgotten. So then we also went to an elderly center and just spent time with the people there. And they were so thankful because they don't get visitors often. And so just having us people come in and sing worship songs and share testimonies. One of the gentlemen came up to me and just said, "Thank you. I was so inspired by you guys and encouraged. And we're just so thankful for your visit." And then this boy and his grandmother on this side, he has cerebral palsy. And his parents have left also. So the grandmother is doing a lot of things every day for this boy. And we ended up giving him a Bible. And he was laughing and just smiling. And they were so thankful for this as well. So you could go to the next one. So then my second 2 weeks, so that was just the first 2 weeks. The second 2 weeks, I joined another team. And we went on a river outreach to more unreached areas of Moldova. So it was in that northeastern part of Moldova. And in these places, there's only Orthodox churches. There's no evangelical churches there and few believers. So Operation Mobilization, who I went with, they've been going for about 5 years into these into this region. And their goal is to help plant churches and start local ministry teams and raise up the believers that are there. So when we would raft on this river and camp along the villages, and we went to 5 villages during this time. And the children remembered the teams coming prior, and they could remember the Bible stories and the songs, and they were so excited to have us there and come back. So they're very open and wanting people to come, and even the families as well. So we did children's programs there, and we would connect with the mayor and the social worker to connect us with families that would like a visit, and we would visit with them as well. So two things that weren't part of our plan and wasn't a part of our goal there, but we got to reach out to the social worker who's on this left-hand side. And she's actually one of the few believers in that village. And she was very encouraged and said, "I'm so thankful to have you guys here and be able to talk about my faith and be able to be encouraged by talking with other believers." And so she was, it was neat to be able to be touched by her and touch her as well. And then this other one, the mayor is on this left-hand side, and he saw that we had extra Bibles and said, "Can I have one? I've been praying for one." And so we had extras, and God provided. And he said, "Praise the Lord, he's provided and answered my prayer." So just so much happened during my time there, and it continues to happen. So you could go to the next slide. So when I was there, like, the Lord just put Psalms 34 on my heart, and I'm going to read only part of it to you guys today. And it says, "I will extol the Lord at all times. His praise will always be on my lips. My soul will boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and rejoice. Glorify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. I sought the Lord, and he answered me. He delivered me from all my fears. Those who look to him are radiant. Their faces are never covered with shame. This poor man called, and the Lord heard him. He saved him out of all his troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear him, and he delivers them. Taste and see that the Lord is good. Blessed is the man who takes refuge in him. Fear the Lord, you his saints, for those who fear him lack nothing." Amen. So with that, I've just got to experience when we follow Jesus, it's sweeter than anything. And we don't lack anything when he's with us, even though there may be and will be challenges in our lives. We're part of proclaiming that message all over the world. And so I'm just thankful I got to be a part of that and actually get to continue to be a part of that. So God, when I was there, really gave me a peace and clarity that this is where he's leading me for long term. So I talked with a lot of people when I was there with the Operation Mobilization. And I actually applied to go back, starting with a 2-year commitment. And I'll be joining their local ministry team. And so, yeah. Here we continue to go. So the other verse since I've been back that God's put on my heart is Proverbs 16:9. And it's this one below: "A man's heart plans his ways, but the Lord directs his steps." And this has become more real to me now with, okay, I have this plan to go back, but I don't know the how and the when exactly, but the Lord does, and he's directing it. So I potentially could be going next August. I'll be support raising this whole year. So if you guys would like to continue to be a part of this in prayer and just updates in financially supporting, just let me know and I'll get your contact information and keep you in the loop on that. So I have a video to show you guys of kind of the overarching thing that happened during this time there. And let me know if you have any other questions or anything like that. Thank you.
Blessed be your name in the land that is plentiful, where your streams of abundance flow. Blessed be your name. Come set your rule and reign.
You know, there's one thing I can tell you about being at the church while I watch young ladies with the courage to go out into the highways and byways. I looked over at my wife and I could see in her heart that she's going, I'm going back. And she's heading for Ecuador next time. And we're working on that. But a 2-year commitment to go to somewhere, that is a commitment of the heart. And only God can put that in a person, a missionary's heart. You see, I'm not called to be a missionary. My wife is. But I'm not. I'm called to take the word out, but also to be a pastor. And I'd love to go, but that's not my calling. But here's the thing I'm trying to tell you is, your calling may not be to go out into the highways and byways and Moldova, but you are called to go out into your city and into your backyard and into your neighborhood and tell them about Jesus and compel them. And one of the most important things you can do is every time, I like what Brother Allen used to say, when you're giving to any ministry, there's a blessing for you and there's a slice of that pie that's yours. Maybe you can understand it in that way. There's a slice of pie that's yours because you helped to move the gospel forward. As a pastor, I want you to know how much I appreciate our sister going and coming and sharing. Let's give her one more hand. Amen. Not only that, she came yesterday and helped with ours. Amen. And that was awesome, and we had a wonderful time. I know that you probably came and went, well, does that pastor ever preach? Yes, I do. It's just there's that time and there's place. You know, it's on the nose right now. I know that you're ready to go home. But I want you to go home with this in your heart. God delights in the man whose feet go forward and do his will. How good, how wonderful, how pleasant, how beautiful are the feet of them that bring good news. And the good news is Jesus Christ is alive today. Amanda, thank you so much. And we'll be talking with our church. And I don't think I have much talk to do because this church has been a missions-sensitive church. We have some in missionaries in... How many of you know we have a missionary in Iraq? And they have 3 kids. And 5 now? Oh, Lord, here's a young man, a young woman with 5 kids, and God called them to Iraq. And they haven't come back. They're still there, and they're still doing God's plan for them. And we have another couple that were in Peru. My wife went down there on a medical mission. For you who don't know, my wife's a nurse practitioner, and her calling is medical missions. And she went down to Peru, and there's now a church there that wasn't there because they, like you said, spontaneously wasn't planned, went to a village when they had time off, and they went there, and because they went there, a church opened with 25 new people worshiping the Lord. And my wife wants to go back, and she'll be going probably to Ecuador this next time. But you know, it takes your support, your desire to see the world evangelized, because when the last names called out and the last soul says, "Here I am," our God's going to give the deed to his son and tell him, "Go get your children." And we're gone. So we have to preach the gospel. Amen. Stand with me. That's all the sermon you get from